Hello, welcome to Bright Times Motorcycling. My name is Brian. Today's episode is all about my GSX 250. I hope you enjoy it. Hi guys, welcome back to 1983. This is the second 1983 episode. Don't forget the first one was the TS125. Hope you all watched that one and enjoyed it. Now we've had a couple of comments from the previous episodes and people like this format where you get all the pictures behind me and get Timmy's brain involved in it as well, which is fantastic. We are going to run news, music and some films, and then we're going to talk about my world, right? My world. God, it was mad in 1983, right? It was a pretty crackers time to live, right? The world had kind of got a bit mad. We just had the Falklands War, so Britain was high on war fever and conservatism and stuff like that. The Russians and the Americans, they were at each other's throats, but the Cold War was reaching kind of like levels of being really dangerous. And we were scared. I remember my parents being nervous about it. I'd go to school and we would talk about it in school. There was all this dive and cover under your desk if a nuclear bomb hit London. There was programs that came out about nuclear war in London and films and stuff like that. It was a really heavy time to live. So a lot of you have asked me in the comments about in the previous show what it was like to live in 1983. And to be honest with you, it was bloody great. For me, I was 17 years old. It was all about sex, drugs and rock and roll. But really the big ones for me, it was the sex and the rock and roll. We'll leave it at that, shall we? Anyway, let's move on. 1983, and the reason we're here is to talk about motorcycles. I have sold my TS125. Much sadness, because it was an absolutely fantastic bike and I loved it. I can't convey to you, I'm sure I can because you watched the previous episode, what a brilliant bike it was and some great adventures I had on it. And it taught me to ride a motorcycle, and it taught me to ride in traffic, and because I was working in London. But I had some sensible friends. Hello Blake and hello Nick. How are you today? My sensible friends, what they did was, they said, no. You know, you can't be buying a 500 or a 750. You've got to go up the line slowly, you know. Blake had a GSX 250 custom bike, which was great. I sat on the back of it and I thought it was absolutely wonderful. I really, really did. Nick, I can't remember what Nick had. I think he had a 250 Super Dream. When your peers are moving up slowly in the ranks of motorcycling, you presume that's the way to go. Now, I could have gone out and bought a 500, 750, 1000, because I had passed my test and it was unlimited, right? There was no limit to what I could buy. But due to my sensible friends, and to be honest with you, cheers lads, I do appreciate it. What I did was, I bought a blue GSX 250 in Chelsea blue, and it was wonderful. Now, what I'm going to do later on is I'm going to discuss about the GSX 250 and its competitors, Super Dream, XS 250 and all that sort of stuff. We'll get to that later. But first of all, let's look at 1983 and let's look at some of the news that was going on in that year. I'll keep it short this time, all right? And then we'll go into me, because after all, as I said before, it's all about me. Right, the news is going to be, let's say there's a military angle to this year. So there's a colonel called Stanislav Petrov. You may not know this because I didn't realize this until not so long ago, but this guy saved our asses. What he did was he pretty much stopped World War III starting. He's in a forward operating base somewhere in Russia, and what happens is beep, 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 beep. The alarms go off, right? Everyone absolutely cacks themselves because you can imagine what that means. That alarm means missiles incoming from America. Everyone's terrified, as you can imagine. Panic ensues, and what Stanislav does is he has a close look at things, right? Rather than just going off and hitting buttons saying like, incoming, incoming! Straight up the chain of command, all the way to Moscow, where they have to make a decision pretty quickly because, you know, it doesn't take very long for the missiles to start reaching Russia, and then a second strike response. He takes a deep breath. He goes to one of his colleagues and says, right, let's look, what's going on? They say, oh, we've got three missiles launched from America. And he says, what, three missiles? Not thousands of missiles. Now, logically, if you're gonna hit a first strike, you'd pretty much use at least half, if not most of your armaments to put a massive strike on the enemy. If you start hitting three or four or five missiles, there's gotta be something wrong. Being the kind of sensible guy he was, because he wasn't military educated, he was a civilian educated man. He took a deep breath, he took a step back, and he looked around and he said, nah, that's not going to happen, and it's not happening. But you can see Europe could have been wasted, America wasted, the whole of the Northern Hemisphere gone. If he'd run up the chain of command and some looser minds had been in control. Thank you, Stanislav. I think the guy needs a pat on the back, and yeah. God bless you, mate. My aunt was married to an American pilot, and we used to love going to the American Air Base. Barbecues, Kool-Aid, it was just fantastic. American accents, sunglasses. It's a great place to be. It was a day out. It was brilliant. But the Americans had bases in the UK which were given to them as part of the Lend-Lease in 1945 after the war. These were like little bits of America, really. And what the Americans did on these air bases, the UK government had absolutely no say at all. You know, like an embassy is a little bit of a foreign land on the country that it's based in. The Americans decided that they would base cruise missiles, nuclear-tipped cruise missiles, in Greenham Common and quite possibly in other bases as well. The news got out and there was uproar about it. The Greenham Common women in big shaggy jumpers and baggy jeans and all that sort of stuff, probably unwashed hair, and what they did was they set up tents outside of the airbase and they made mayhem. They cut the wires, they chuck things in the base, and they made news as much as they could. Now, we never actually found out whether the Americans removed the missiles from Greenham Common, but the world got together. It wasn't just the Greenham Common women, but there was the campaign for nuclear disarmament was in the UK, and it was a very big and strong organization. And let's not forget, the UK had just come off a war in the Falklands, and there was quite a lot of military thinking going on and jingoistic, yeah, Great Britain and all that sort of stuff, right? And that's neither here nor there. I'm not gonna have an issue on it. I was 17 and I was like, yeah, go England. People looked at the Greenland Common women and they said, right, we wanna go out and we wanna protest. 1 million people in London campaigning against nuclear weapons and for nuclear disarmament. Now, I'll tell you one thing, nowhere in Europe reached the numbers that were reached in London that day, considering all the nuclear weapons were based in Europe facing Russia. So the battleground would be Europe, not America. Now, listen, American viewers, I'm not slagging you off or your governments or anything like that. It was a tense time and it was tough, all right? And the Russians, yeah, like we didn't like the Russians and they probably didn't like us. So what happened happened. But people power got together. And to be honest with you, Ronald Reagan sat down with Gorbachev. They listened to the population. That's huge. They say revolutions start small and grow big. There is thousands of nuclear weapons out there today, but let's put it this way. If it wasn't for the SALT treaties and people power in the 80s, there could be a hell of a lot more. The third thing that happened that year was MASH. Now, we all love MASH. I watched MASH all of my life, really. I was born in 1966, and MASH was, well, I don't know when the first episode started, but there was 256 of them. So, as you can imagine, from, you know, a wee lad to all the way to 1983, MASH was always on the telly. Everyone loved MASH. So it had to end at some point, didn't it, really? In saying that, the Simpsons are still running. Tim, are they running?
Yeah.
Yeah. See, Simpsons are still going. It won loads of awards. All the characters, we all know them by first names. And in Australia, where I live now, it's always on. Right, let's talk about music in 1983, because the music, as we've seen in the previous episode, there was some amazing music in the 80s. We had some great bands. Now, I've talked about it in the previous episode, I'm not going to re-go over those bands again, but if we talk about War, U2 brought out War, and from that came the songs Sunday, Bloody Sunday, and Two Hearts Beat as One. Right, Billy Idol, every girl's dream. Didn't every girl in the world love Billy Idol? My sister had him on the wall, my friend Kate had him on the wall, and he was a very good looking guy. He brought out White Wedding and Rebel Yell. Cracking good rock songs, yeah? Now, David Bowie. Now, I'm surprised I didn't look at Bowie in the first the TS-125 episode. He absolutely killed it in 1983. He brought out the songs China Girl, Modern Love. Now, arguably, they were two of his best songs, and I don't quite remember him doing anything as good as that afterwards. Them two songs, I've got playlists, right? And there's always one of them songs on my playlist, China Girl and Modern Love. That drum beat in Modern Love, because I'm a drummer, don't forget, we're going to talk about that in a minute. But the New Romantics, they'd come to town. They'd all look cool, right? With Adamant, for example, you know, his pirate dress, and myself and Tim, my co-Bright Times person. He actually admitted he wore one of those shirts with all the buttons down the side. Yeah, whilst I was just wearing leather and rubber. No, not rubber. Leather and a jean jacket. But anyway, New Romantics. They had the most fantastic hairdos and they had the best clothes. None more exemplified by Duran Duran in Rio. Now, you probably remember the video on the boat. Now, apparently they chucked all their dough into making this one video called Rio, hired a yacht, dressed up in all these cool suits, went out and filmed Rio. The song was an absolute monster hit. And there was loads of other New Romantic bands. I'm not gonna go into it now because I haven't got time. I hope you like the theme tune, by the way, Heaven 17, Temptation, because, you know, there's a little thing about temptation as well, because don't forget, when you're 17, life's all about temptation, isn't it? Right, there were some pretty good films in 1983, and again in the previous episode, which I don't mean to be harping on about the previous episode. If you've not watched it, go and watch it. Like, subscribe and watch it, and you'll get notified about all of this stuff, right? Had to chuck that one in there for the moment. But Staying Alive came out in 1983. Now, that was a sequel to Saturday Night Fever. John Travolta dancing, pouting, looking good with his wow haircut, right? Again, like Duran Duran, funky suits, big collars. That was a great film. It wasn't my kind of film, but it was a really, really big film in 1983. Now, do you remember when we were talking about War? And we've talked about War quite a lot. There was something called The Day After. Now, that was a TV series. And to add insult to injury, when we're all terrified about nuclear war and bombs and Greenham Common and cruise missiles and all that sort of stuff, some bright spark decides to make a film or a TV series called The Day After. Now, to be honest with you, that scared the living daylights out of everybody because it was quite realistic. That put the wobbles up. A lot of people watching that. I wouldn't quite say it was as bad as War of the Worlds, but it was pretty scary, you know? And maybe that contributed to the uprising we talked about earlier in the news. People seeing that and going, oh my Lord, I do not want that to happen to me. Two Bond films that year, both of them rubbish. There'd been a split in the Bond franchise, right? So Roger Moore and Sean Connery brought out two films. One of them was called Octopussy. The other one was called Never Say Never Again. Octopussy had Roger Moore. Never Say Never Again had Sean Connery. Admittedly, an aging Sean Connery. But, you know, Bond's got to get old, like the rest of us. Anyway, they're rubbish. Now, we are going to talk about me, and I am a rock star in 1983. And I'm going to tell you all about it.